Greetings and welcome back to room 303 in Sophomore English. We are in the sixth unit now, and we are on page 1074, 1075, the orphan dog and the orphan boy and the elk dog story, and more particularly the Blackfeet Native American tribe that are responsible for this story. Hey, read with me on 1075 really quickly. The Blackfeet are one of the many Native American nations that have lived on the Great Plains of North America. At one time, most Plains Indians were farmers who lived in one place, grew their own food, sometimes hunted buffalo on foot. Then, in the 1600s, many tribes captured and tamed wild horses. In time, the Blackfeet became skillful riders, and horses transformed their way of life. A mounted hunter could search for game more efficiently. Hunting replaced farming, and the tribes followed the buffalo herds. Today, the Blackfeet live on reservations in Montana and in Canada. Myths like the orphan boy and the elk dog reflect the importance of the horse in early Blackfeet culture. The name Blackfeet is a reference to the dark moccasins worn by early Blackfeet people. As for the background for this myth on page 1075, read it with me. The orphan boy and the elk dog explains the origin of an important part of North American Blackfeet culture, horses. Horses did not always exist in North America. Spanish explorer Cortes brought the first horses to Mexico in 1519, and they quickly spread northward. By the 1600s, many Native American tribes had captured and tamed wild horses. So let's go to work now. In this selection, we're going to hear a myth now about an outcast young man who goes on a dangerous quest to prove himself to his people and to prove his own self-worth. At 3A already, go ahead and write this one down. By the Waters of Babylon will be a companion read for us. So let's enjoy this story now. Follow along, conquer monkey mind, and enjoy a story like this, which is in fact a myth, right?
The Orphan Boy and the Elk Dog. Native American, Blackfeet. In the days when people had only dogs to carry their bundles, two orphan children, a boy and his sister, were having a hard time. The boy was deaf, and because he could not understand what people said, they thought him foolish and dull-witted. Even his relatives wanted nothing to do with him. The name he had been given at birth, while his parents still lived, was Long Arrow. Now, he was like a beaten, mangy dog, the kind who hungrily roams outside a camp, circling it from afar, smelling the good meat boiling in the kettles, but never coming close for fear of being kicked. Only his sister, who was bright and beautiful, loved him. Then the sister was adopted by a family from another camp, people who were attracted by her good looks and pleasing ways. Though they wanted her for a daughter, they certainly did not want the awkward, stupid boy, and so they took away the only person who cared about him, and the orphan boy was left to fend for himself. He lived on scraps thrown to the dogs and things he found on the refuse heaps. He dressed in remnants of skins and frayed robes discarded by the poorest people. At night, he bedded down in a grass-lined dugout, like an animal in its den. Eventually, the game was hunted out near the camp that the boy regarded as his, and the people decided to move. The lodges were taken down. Belongings were packed into rawhide bags and put on dog travoy, and the village departed. "Stay here," they told the boy. "We don't want your kind coming with us." For 2 or 3 days, the boy fed on scraps the people had left behind, but he knew he would starve if he stayed. He had to join his people, whether they liked it or not. He followed their tracks, frantic that he would lose them, and crying at the same time. Soon, the sweat was running down his skinny body. As he was stumbling, running, panting, something suddenly snapped in his left ear with a sound like a small crack, and a worm-like substance came out of that ear. All at once, on his left side, he could hear bird songs for the first time. He took this worm-like thing in his left hand and hurried on. Then there was a snap in his right ear, and a worm-like thing came out of it. And on his right side, he could hear the rushing waters of a stream. His hearing was restored, and it was razor sharp. He could make out the rustling of a tiny mouse in dry leaves a good distance away. The orphan boy laughed and was happy for the first time in his life. With renewed courage, he followed the trail his people had made.
All right, let's pause for a second, put in level one. Notice we start out, it's a pretty pathetic situation. Young boy treated really badly, abandoned. Ultimately, even his own sister, the only one that cares for him, is now gone. And left, completely left, all alone, unto his own. Now, what's going on with these worms coming out of his ear? Usually symbolic for what? The moment when he decides to be assertive. This is my life. I have to live my life. That moment when he no longer is going to accept the way people have seen him, perceived him. This will be kind of important in our reading of the myth, because obviously it sets the type, the stereotype of this warrior who is going to go off in search of defining who he is. All right, let's keep going. You're now into the story. Wonder what happens next.
In the meantime, the village had settled into its new place. Men were already out hunting. Thus, the boy came upon good running, a kindly old chief butchering a fat buffalo cow he had just killed.
1078.
When the chief saw the boy, he said to himself, "Here comes that poor, good-for-nothing boy. It was wrong to abandon him." To the boy, Good Running said, "Rest here, grandson. You're sweaty and covered with dust. Here, have some tripe." The boy wolfed down the meat. He was not used to hearing and talking yet, but his eyes were alert, and Good Running also noticed a change in his manner. "This boy," the chief said to himself, "is neither stupid nor crazy." He gave the orphan a piece of the hump meat, then a piece of liver, then a piece of raw kidney, and at last the very best kind of meat, a slice of tongue. The more the old man looked at the boy, the more he liked him. On the spur of the moment, he said, "Grandson, I'm going to adopt you. There's a place for you in my teepee, and I'm going to make you into a good hunter and warrior." The boy wept, this time for joy. Good Running said, "They called you a stupid, crazy boy, but now that I think of it, the name you were given at birth is Long Arrow. I'll see that people call you by your right name. Now come along."
All right, let's pause, write it down at level one. Again, this is what good readers do. We read for a little bit, then we pause, then we summarize. So here we go, let's summarize. Notice second act, second movement of this story. Recognition by the old chief. He realizes there's something in this kid. I'm going to go ahead and adopt him. I'm going to give him a chance. Already at 3B, we could ask this question. Do you have somebody in your life already who has helped this to happen? Who has helped you to discover your hidden talents, your abilities, who has motivated you to be better, to say to you, you can be more. But notice right away, just because Long Arrow is going to be recognized by the chief doesn't mean that everybody else will accept him as such. Let's keep reading. Watch what happens next.
The chief's wife was not pleased. "Why do you put this burden on me?" she said, "bringing into our lodge this good-for-nothing, this slow-witted, crazy boy. Maybe you're a little slow-witted and crazy yourself."
1079.
"Keep talking like that, and I'll beat you. This boy isn't slow or crazy. He's a good boy, and I have taken him for my grandson. Look, he's barefooted. Hurry up and make a pair of moccasins for him, and if you don't do it well, I'll take a stick to you." Good Running's wife grumbled, but did as she was told. Her husband was a kind man, but when aroused, his anger was great. So a new life began for Long Arrow. He had to learn to speak and to understand well, and to catch up on all the things a boy should know. He was a fast learner and soon surpassed other boys his age in knowledge and skills. At last, even Good Running's wife accepted him.
Now, let's just pause for a moment. Of course, we've got to address the issue of this violence or intended violence towards women. Clearly, this is a problem in our reading, no doubt, especially for us today as we read a text like this. The patriarchy, of course, long in establishment in tribal cultures like this, we know. And yet, at the same time, there is the other side of this. That is to say, the chief, the old man, sees something in this kid. They bring him into a family. Let's put this at 2A. One of the clear messages already of this myth is, you are a product of your environment. If you're not accepted, if you're not supported, if you're not loved, if you're not nourished, then you've got problems. But when you are brought into an environment where you're supported and loved and encouraged, amazing things can happen. The other major message here is, notice, it takes the chief's wife a while to come around to the realization this is a good kid who is in need of some love and encouragement. Let's see now what happens to Long Arrow and some of the important journeys he will take.
He grew up into a fine young hunter, tall and good-looking in the quilled buckskin outfit the chief's wife made for him. He helped his grandfather in everything and became a staff for Good Running to lean on. But he was lonely, for most people in the camp could not forget that Long Arrow had been an outcast. "Grandfather," he said one day, "I want to do something to make you proud and show people that you were wise to adopt me. What can I do?" Good Running answered, "Someday you will be a chief and do great things." "But what's a great thing I can do now, Grandfather?" The chief thought for a long time. "Maybe I shouldn't tell you this," he said. "I love you and don't want to lose you. But on winter nights, men talk of powerful spirit people living at the bottom of a faraway lake. Down in that lake, the spirit people keep mystery animals who do their work for them. These animals are larger than a great elk, but they carry the burdens of the spirit people like dogs. So they're called Pono Kamita, elk dogs. They are said to be swift, strong, gentle, and beautiful beyond imagination. Every fourth generation, one of our young warriors has gone to find these spirit folk and bring back an elk dog for us. But none of our brave young men has ever returned." "Grandfather, I'm not afraid. I'll go and find the elk dog." "Grandson, first learn to be a man. Learn the right prayers and ceremonies. Be brave. Be generous and open-handed. Pity the old and the fatherless, and let the holy men of the tribe find a medicine for you which will protect you on your dangerous journey. We will begin by purifying you in the sweat bath." So Long Arrow was purified with the white steam of the sweat lodge. He was taught how to use the pipe and how to pray to the great mystery power. The tribe's holy men gave him a medicine and made for him a shield with designs on it to ward off danger.
1080.
Then one morning, without telling anybody, Good Running loaded his best travoy dog with all the things Long Arrow would need for traveling. The chief gave him his medicine, his shield, and his own fine bow, and, just as the sun came up, went with his grandson to the edge of the camp to purify him with sweet-smelling cedar smoke. Long Arrow left unheard and unseen by anyone else. After a while, some people noticed that he was gone, but no one except his grandfather knew where and for what purpose.
All right, now let's jump to 3A. Do you remember when we did that text by the waters of Babylon? Do you remember that before the young man leaves and goes across the Hudson into the New York City that now no longer is the old New York City, do you remember that he has to go through the purification rites? In other words, Manet is playing a game that comes from this myths like this one, where before the young man has to grow up to a certain point, but then to get ready to leave, he has to have the blessings of the elders. By the way, back on page 1079, did you see it? The advice that's given to him about what it is that he needs to be. Notice, you gotta be brave. You gotta learn the right prayers and ceremonies. You gotta show respect. Be generous and open-handed. Pity the old and the fatherless. This is the code, right? And let the holy men of the tribe find medicine for you. All of this is central, of course, to the teachings of this myth. In a word, respect. Respect of the old ways, respect of the traditions. All right, we're now ready for the second part of the story, obviously the journey. And as we have said, one of the oldest motifs, one of the oldest archetypes in the history of storytelling is the journey, the odyssey. Let's now watch it. Off he's going, of course, to look for Elk Dog, right?
Following Good Running's advice, Long Arrow wandered southward. On the fourth day of his journey, he came to a small pond where a strange man was standing as if waiting for him. "Why have you come here?" the stranger asked. "I have come to find the mysterious Elk Dog." "Ah, there I cannot help you," said the man, who was the spirit of the pond. "But if you travel further south, 4 times 4 days, you might chance upon a bigger lake, and there meet one of my uncles. Possibly he might talk to you. Then again, he might not. That's all I can tell you."
1081.
Long Arrow thanked the man, who went down to the bottom of the pond where he lived. Long Arrow wandered on, walking for long hours and taking little time for rest. Through deep canyons and over high mountains he went, wearing out his moccasins and enduring cold and heat, hunger and thirst. Finally, Long Arrow approached a big lake surrounded by steep pine-covered hills. There, he came face to face with a tall man, fierce and scowling, and twice the height of most humans. This stranger carried a long lance with a heavy spear point made of shining flint. "Young one," he growled, "why did you come here?" "I came to find the mysterious Elk Dog." The stranger, who was the spirit of the lake, stuck his face right into Long Arrow's and shook his mighty lance. "Little one, aren't you afraid of me?" he snarled. "No, I am not," answered Long Arrow, smiling.
Courage, right? Courage.
The tall spirit man gave a hideous grin, which was his way of being friendly. "I like small humans who aren't afraid," he said, "but I can't help you. Perhaps our grandfather will take the trouble to listen to you. More likely he won't. Walk south 4 times 4 days, and maybe you'll find him, but probably you won't." With that, the tall spirit turned his back on Long Arrow and went to the bottom of the lake where he lived.
Now, this kind, write it down at level 1 and even at 2B, this kind of repetition, not unusual. You'll see this in many, many legends and myths, where you'll have this kind of story where we're going, notice, farther and farther and farther away from home. That's the key, yes? In other words, the journey is defined by distancing oneself from where one came from. And in the process of doing this, you come face to face with things that horrify or potentially horrify you, and then you have to show a certain amount of courage to overcome those things. All right, let's move on. What happens to Long Arrow next?
Long Arrow walked on for another 4 times 4 days, sleeping and resting little. By now, he staggered and stumbled in his weakness, and his dog was not much better off. At last, he came to the biggest lake he had ever seen, surrounded by towering snow-capped peaks and waterfalls of ice. This time, there was nobody to receive him. As a matter of fact, there seemed to be no living thing around. This must be the Great Mystery Lake, thought Long Arrow. Exhausted, he fell down upon the short grass meadow by the lake, fell down among the wild flowers, and went to sleep with his tired dog curled up at his feet.
So he's finally made it, right?
When Long Arrow awoke, the sun was already high. He opened his eyes and saw a beautiful child standing before him, a boy in a dazzling white buckskin robe decorated with porcupine quills of many colors. The boy said, "We have been expecting you for a long time. My grandfather invites you to his lodge. Follow me." Telling his dog to wait, Long Arrow took his medicine shield and his grandfather's bow and went with the wonderful child.
1082.
They came to the edge of the lake. The spirit boy pointed to the water and said, "My grandfather's lodge is down there. Come." The child turned himself into a kingfisher and dove straight to the bottom. Afraid, Long Arrow thought, "How can I follow him and not be drowned?" But then he said to himself, "I knew all the time that this would not be easy. In setting out to find the elk dog, I already threw my life away." And he boldly jumped into the water. To his surprise, he found it did not make him wet, that it parted before him, that he could breathe and see. He touched the lake's sandy bottom. It sloped down, down toward a center point. Long Arrow descended this slope until he came to a small, flat valley. In the middle of it stood a large teepee of tanned buffalo hide.